الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Tonight inshallah we will continue with the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and reflections on those names and explanation of the names, but most important, the names in our life, how those names should be utilized in our life and should be put into practice, as we have established this objective long time ago since we started. And today we are with one of the great names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and perhaps a lot of us these days, especially due to what's happening in the Muslim world, more especially in the Middle East, we get to understand this name from a different angle, and we get to see this name and see what it really means to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Al-Jabbar, Al-Jabbar. And that is the name that we are to address tonight, inshallah. And Al-Jabbar has many meanings in the Arabic. The roots of the word Al-Jabbar, or the name Al-Jabbar, carries many meanings. And perhaps some of the meanings seem to be contradictory to each other. Yet it's one, and each one serves different purpose when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فمثلا يعني the root جبر أجبر أجبره يعني أكره أجبره يعني أكره. To using this word or the root of الجبار means to coerce, to force, to compel. And also the word الجبر الجبر يعني خلاف الكسر إصلاح الكسر يسمى جبر. أن ترى المسح في كتب الفقه المسح على الخفين والجبيرة. الجبر also to fix what's been broken. Okay, to fix what's been broken. That's also served, or this meaning served with the root of the word or the name Al-Jabbar. And also Al-Jabr أن تغني الرجل عن الفقر أو تغني الرجل من الفقر. Also Al-Jabr means to take someone out of poverty. Okay, to suffice someone and to make him or to take him out of faqr, out of poverty. That's also one of the meanings of Al-Jabr. And also تجبر النبت يعني إذا خضر وأورق. النبت or the plants, they use the same verb with it. That when they indicate or when they refer to when it flourishes, okay, and when it gives fruits and becomes green, they use the same root from الجبر. And also الجبار أي العظيم القوي الطويل. العظيم, the great, the magnificent. العظيم, طويل, the all height, all tall, as we will see what that means regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also that can be الجبار يعني القوي. We know in Surah Al-Ma'idة where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says يعني when Bani Israel were commanded to enter Bayt al-Maqdis, they said إن فيها قوما جبارين. إن فيها قوما جبارين. There are people in there جبارين. And there يعني many إسرائيليات. That those were giants and they used to carry the irregular human beings in their hide them in their cuff. All that تخاريف and has no basis. But جبارين here يعني they're strong. Okay. بأسهم بينهم شديد. They were strong and they were tough. And Bani Israel, as they are known throughout the years and the ages, something happens in Libya and they are so scared in where they are living and they're so worried. And that is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them to be always coward and scared and fearing the bugs around them. So anyway, so this is very much the meanings of the root of Jabbar and the origin of the word. And also they said تجبر الرجل إذا تكبر. تجبر الرجل إذا تكبر. When someone is described with this verb, it refers that he's being arrogant. He's being arrogant. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Yahya عليه السلام, and he describes Isa عليه السلام, ولم يكن جبارا شقيا, ولم يجعلني جبارا شقيا. وبرا بوالدتي ولم يجعلني جبارا شقيا. بات عيسى عليه السلام. So here جبارا يعني متكبر. متكبر. Allah did not make me, made me obedient to my mother and did not make me arrogant, and متكبر and شقي, oppressor and transgressor, as we will see all these meanings. So also يعني when we say جبار, we are referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this attribute, and that is al-kibr, that is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he is the one who deserves to have that characters. In the Quran, the name al-jabbar is mentioned, describing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned one time. Okay, in the Quran, when the word al-jabbar describes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned only one time. But the word al-jabbar or jabbar without al-ta'rif, that is mentioned many times. But here we are concerned about it coming in the Quran to describe Allah Azza wa Jal. And that is in Surah Al-Hashr, as the names we have been going over one by one. Al-Malik al-Quddus al-Salam al-Mu'min al-Aziz al-Jabbar. المهيمن العزيز الجبار الجبار. And next time we'll talk about إن شاء الله المتكبر. معنى الاسم في حق الله. طيب, this is the meaning of the names or the root of the name. طيب, what do we mean by الجبار when we talk about Allah سبحانه وتعالى؟ قال الطبري رحمه الله يعني المصلح أمور خلقه. Remember we said one of the meanings of الجبار is to fix what's been broken. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being al-jabbar, يعني he is the one who fixes the affairs of his creation. Okay? He is the one who fixes the affairs of his creation. The way he wishes and the way he wants. وقال قتادة جبر خلقه على ما يشاء من أمره. And that's the other meaning, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-jabbar means he coerced his creations for what he wants. Okay, he coerces them for what he wants. يعني he is making them do what he wants. And there is no contradictory between this and القضاء والقدر, as we will describe إن شاء الله. وقال الخطابي رحمه الله هو الذي جبر الخلق على ما أراده من أمره ونهيه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-jabbar, meaning he is the one who instituted his creation to do what he wants and to stay away from what he wants. And we will see what they did with that. وَيُقَالُ هُوَ الَّذِي جَبَرَ مَفَاقِرَ الْخَلْقِ وَكَفَاهُمْ أَسْبَابَ الْمَعَاشِ وَالرِّزْقِ. Also al-jabbar, if we go to the other meaning, that to suffice someone and take him out of poverty, then al-jabbar, regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the one who suffices his creation. Salaam alaykum. He's the one who suffices his creation, okay, and take them out of the poverty and their needs. طيب. So that is one of the meanings of al-jabbar, going back to the roots. وقال الشوكاني رحمه الله
جبروت الله عظمته, والعرب تسمي الملك جبار. Okay. جبروت العظمة, and the Arabs call the king, the king, because he is the one who has يعني very much control over his رعية and those whom he's in charge of. They call him جبار. They call the king جبار. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى الجبار. وقال الجبار العالي فوق خلق. Remember we said الجبار also one of the meanings is العظيم الطويل بالطول. يعني the Arabs call when there is a huge tree, palm tree, نخلة, huge, so high and so tall, they call it جبارة. Why they call it جبارة? Because no one can reach the fruits. No one can reach the fruits, the dates, rutab. So they call it جبارة. This tree is جبارة. You have no access. And when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الجبار, يعني Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is over his creation. No one has access to him. No one can harm him. No one can benefit him. No one can get to him. No one can intercede with him without his permission subhanahu wa ta'ala. So also they derived this meaning of Al-Jabbar. So you see many meanings for the name Al-Jabbar, which a lot of us يعني read the name and نمر عليه مرور الكرام. We pass it as if it means nothing. And maybe we يعني the most we know about it, Al-Jabbar is the dominant. Al-Jabbar is the one who is so powerful. Al-Jabbar is the one who controls. That's all. And we don't see the wider picture. قال السعدي رحمه الله هو بمعنى العلي الأعلى. الأعلى, سبح اسم ربك الأعلى. الأعلى يعني the one who's on over his creation. He is higher than all of his creation. وبمعنى القهار. قهار يعني the one no one has choice but to submit to him. وبمعنى الرؤوف الجابر للقلوب المنكسرة. And also is means الرؤوف, the merciful, the kind, the one who fix the broken hearts. Remember we said to fix the broken it comes from the same root. So Allah يجبر القلوب المنكسرة, that I know Allah الجبار with me. So as you can see, this name can be on this side of the spectrum and can be on this side. الجبار can be القاهر, القاهر للظالمين, and can be الرؤوف للمظلومين سبحانه وتعالى. He's جبار and he has full power and full control and over those, and he can destroy them, الجبار, those who are transgressors, and at the same time الجبار, he can fix the affairs and what those oppressors have broken and have destroyed with those oppressed people. الجبار. Okay. So you can see the name and what it means. So from all these meanings, we can come up with, from all the opinions and all the roots, we can come to see that the name Al-Jabbar for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can mean one of four things or one of three things. Al-Jabbar huwa al-ali ala khalqi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Al-Jabbar, يعني he's the one over his creation. It. No one goes over him subhanahu wa ta'ala. His word nafidha will go through. Okay? وَلَوْ بَعْدَ حِينَ لِحِكْمَةٍ أَرَادَهَا. For a wisdom he chooses. Whether it takes place now or later, Allah chooses for hikmah. Okay? Allah al-Hakim, he chooses. So don't say why is this happening and why is that happening and where is Allah? La. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he allows things to happen, not because he likes them. Not everything goes in the world because Allah loves it. Because obviously Allah doesn't love shirk. Allah doesn't love zina. Allah doesn't love al-haraj wal-maraj wal-qatl. Allah doesn't love riba. But they take place. So you have to understand that the fact these things taking place doesn't mean Allah is approving it. But these things will not take place without the permission of Allah. Very important. Because a lot of people get mixed up. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-ra'uf al-raheem al-ghafoor al-wadood al-latif al-mannan, why would he allow these things to take place? Allah. This question is out of place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wise, al-hakim, and when He allowed these things to happen, for a reason. When He makes someone suffer, for a reason. When a little child gets cancer, for a reason. When someone dies from an accident, for a reason. And as they said, if you were able to see, if you were able, or the doors of the unseen of al-ghayb were open to you, and you will see why Allah will let things happen, then you will ask for more. When one of us goes through a hardship, some of us react the proper way. إِنَّا لِلَّهُ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَجْعُونَ Some of us are patient. Some of us deal with it. Some of us accept it. Some of us get angry. Some of us don't accept it. Some of us start questioning the hikmah and the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People are different levels. But if all these people were able to see why Allah allowed this hardship to happen to each one of them, then they would have asked for more. But we don't see the hikmah, and that is part of the test. Because if Allah is going to show you the reason right off the hook, right away, or even before it happens, then there is no place for testing you. How are we going to test your patience? How are we going to test your acceptance? How are we going to test your perseverance? How are we going to test your faith? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hides the hikmah of this, and perhaps you will never find out, or you will find out shortly. Someone, if you look, for example, the story of Musa with Al-Khadr, and you know how they passed, if those people, when they ride in the boat, and when they kill the child, the ghulam, and when they fix the wound, but if those people who owned the boat would have seen Al-Khadr breaking their boat, they would have got angry. Especially as the hadith said that they carried them without ujra. They did not charge them. Free cab. They didn't charge them. So imagine they were able to see, or they would have seen Al-Khadr. They would have get offended. And maybe they kicked them out. Maybe they thrown them in the water. You don't know. Because this is when the stab comes from someone you've done ma'roof to, and you've done something good to, it hurts more than someone you've never done anything good to. So perhaps they would have been upset, but there is a hikmah that if they would have known why Al-Khadr did it, they would have accepted it, and they would have even, maybe they would have done it themselves, and the same thing would have happened with Musa alayhi salam. He would have accepted it too, and he would have not asked. Maybe he would have helped Al-Khadr to do it. The same thing with the child. Don't you think that the parents of this child were upset? When they found that their kid, that they loved so much, was killed? Sure. Don't you think they cried? Most probably. Actually, as you see why he did it, that indicates that they were in so much love for this child. They loved him so much. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Al-Khadr to kill him. Why? So he does not misguide his parents to kufr. He does not take his parents out of iman to disbelief. So imagine how much they loved him to reach that point. They were upset, they were sad. But if they would have known the results, or they would have known the cause or the reason why he did that, and why Allah ordered him to do that, they would have been satisfied. They actually, maybe they would have killed him themselves. True? So if the doors of the unseen were open to you, because why things happen, that's from the unseen, then you would have accepted and welcomed it. And each of us has experience, and each of us has something that goes on in his life that he can reflect. Few months, few years down the road, he looks back, he said, Subhanallah, I was so upset that I could not get that job. Or I was upset I did not get that deal. Or I was upset I did not go that trip. And then he looks down the road and he realized that because he did not go there and he went the other way, or he did not take that job, he took the other job, or he did not go through that deal, he went with another deal. He's very successful now. And those who had the job crying that he was upset about. So always you need to trust in the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why al-Jabbar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the one who fixes the affairs of his creation. The one, when he says, this is what you need to do, is because it will fix your affairs. It will be better for your affairs and for your life, dunya wa akhirah. So al-Jabbar al-Ali ala khalqih wal-muslih lil-umuri wa aydan al-qahir khalqah. Okay? Al-qahir khalqah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-qahir khalqahu or khalqihi, Allah, the one who coerced his creation. Yani his creation got no choice if it has to do with them competing with Allah. What Allah says goes. Halas. And we will see that this is the fact with all the creation except two. Al-ins wal-jinn. Not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot control them, on the contrary. La, because he gave them the choice. Every other creation, khalas. They submitted. But the ins and the jinn, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the choice. So let's see what this al-Jabbar, name al-Jabbar, we can learn from this name so we can apply into our life. Huh? Into our life. In our daily activities. These names, if we were to take the names of Allah and apply them into our lives, wallahi, we will change the world. Not only ourselves, not only our homes, not only our communities, not only our the whole world. As I said before, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You are the best nation or the best community produced for mankind. So الخيرية comes when we are together as an ummah. And one of the benefits of being the best ummah is we benefit mankind. للناس. When you're good, everyone around you will benefit. So let's see what name al-Jabbar gives me as a Muslim and teaches me as a Muslim and tell me as a Muslim to do in my life. Inna Allah ta'ala al-Jabbar lahu al-uluwu ala khalq. يعني الجبار, as I said already and as we said the meaning, Allah on top of his creation. No one can reach him to harm him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no one can reach him to benefit him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is completely independent of his creation. It doesn't matter what they do, whether they kill, whether they commit adultery or fornicate 24/7, or they pray and they prostrate and they bow and they make dua and they read Quran 24/7. Doesn't change Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't change the kingdom of Allah. Because if any of these things would have increased or decreased the kingdom of Allah, then there would have been some kind or some percentage of dependence of Allah on His creation to increase His kingdom or to decrease it. And that is take Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the status that He deserves or a God deserves. Very important to understand this fact. يعني the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says in Hadith Qudsi, لن تبلغوا ضري فتضروني ولن تبلغوا نفعي فتنفعوني. يعني even addressing human being, even and creation, even if you try to harm me, you can't even get there. Not you cannot harm me, you cannot even get in a state to harm me. There's a difference. Okay, يعني someone says, with my team, I can win the Super Bowl. But you're not even in the NFL. For example, okay, that's something يعني can relate better to the people. You're not even getting, you're not even able to get into the NFL. You're talking about Super Bowl. ولله المثل just to make you comprehend it a little better. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لن تبلغوا ضري فتضرون. Allah doesn't say, you will not be able to harm me. You will not be able to be in a position to harm me. So it's completely something impossible. Okay? The same thing with the other, to benefit Allah. You cannot benefit me. You cannot be in a position to benefit. You cannot even get there to think, okay, now I can benefit Allah. No. Allah, who had given everything around you and who had given you everything, doesn't need your benefit. And we know the Hadith al-Qudusi, لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أتقى قلب رجل واحد منكم ما زاد ذلك في ملك شيئا ولو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجن كانوا على أفجر قلب رجل واحد منكم ما نقص ذلك من ملك شيئا. خلاص. All people and all the jinn and all the creation gathered together, do not benefit Allah and do not harm Allah. Do not even get there. Okay? So very important to understand. So once you understand, this is one of the attributes and one of the characters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then who is with his wise or full mind will ally with someone else? Who will take wali other than Allah? Who will seek refuge in other than Allah? Who wants protection from other than Allah? Kings, leaders, presidents, authorities, governments, la. When it comes to al-Jabbar, he is above all and he's on top of all. They have no word. When it comes, maybe they have a word between them and other people. Maybe they have a word over the weak and the poor and the old. But they have no word over them. They can't get anywhere. Also, you learn from this that أَنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى جَبَرَ خَلْقَهُ جَبَرَ خَلْقَهُ عَلَى مَا أَرَادَ أَنْ يَكُونَ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forced them, forced His creation. And we will say the exception for that. Allah forced His creation for what He wants. What Allah wants, al-Jabbar, the creations do. They have no choice, no other option. Allah gave them one choice, an ultimatum. And if they would have refused, He would have forced them to do it. But they were wise and they were smarter than the exception. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون. The order of Allah is when He wants something, He says be and it will be. In more details, Allah سبحانه وتعالى says أفغير دين الله يبغون وله أسلم من في السماوات والأرض طوعا وكرها. They want a religion other than Allah, and everything in the heavens and the earth submitted to Allah, whether out of choice or by force, everything submitted to Allah. The heavens, the earth, the mountains, the rivers, the trees, the animals, the creation, everything, the angels submitted to Allah. Whether they want it or they not, they submitted. وعليكم السلام. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى ثم استوى إلى السماء وهي دخان فقال لها وللأرض ائتيا طوعا أو كرها. قالتا أتينا طائعين. الله سبحانه وتعالى after he got over his throne, he said to the heavens and the earth, تيا طوعا. Now you submit. You're gonna submit طوعا أو كرها. I give you an ultimate. Submit. If you choose to do that, great. If you don't choose to do that, then I will force you to do. They said, أتينا طائعين.
said, no, no. You are Allah who created us. We know what you can do with us. We will submit willingly. We know you can force us to submit, but we will submit willingly. But human and تكبر تجبر. يعني when one of the قضاة came to him, one of the elite Jewish man who had a problem or يعني an issue, a case with a poor man. So they came to this qadi, and this elite had connection with the wife of the Khalifa. Not Suzanne. And not Tarabulsi. And what's this guy's name? His wife. The other guy. But I always say, إِنَّ الْبَقَرَةُ عَلَيْهِ. He had connection, this Jew had connection with the wife of the... So he thought he gonna come one day, he will rule for his in his favor and die. So when the Qadi listened, and he found that the Jew had this elite, this good elite man, respectful man, connection with the wife of the Khalifa was the wrong one. He ruled for the poor. So this Jewish man gets on top of his donkey and he starts going away, but he's hitting the donkey with the harshness. فقال له القاضي يعني أنسيت اسمه. قال له القاضي شوف قال له قبحك الله فإن هذا الحمار أذكر لله. القاضي told him, and this is very profound statement. He told him يعني what's wrong with you? How dare you do this to the donkey? He knows Allah more than you. Why? Because the donkey has submitted to Allah already. Animals are on the tawheed. They pray, when they praise Allah. And when they pray to Allah. But this Jew who has deviated from the straight path and the path of Allah, indeed he was worse than this donkey who establishes the order of Allah. So they have hearts, but they do not reflect with. They have eyes they don't see with. They have ears they don't hear with. إِنْهُمْ كَالْأَنْعَابَ. They are like animals. No, no, no. They are even. Why they are worse? Because the animal, when he was given the option, he chose to submit. Them, they were given the options, they chose to go the other way. فإنها لا تعمل أبصار ولكن تعمل القلوب التي في الصدور. خلاص. So the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that everything in this universe submits to Allah, and they had no choice. Man and jinn had the options. And some people chose this way to obey Allah, and the others chose the other way. يقول الله subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ أحلت لكم بهيمة الأنعام إلا ما يتلى عليكم غير محل الصيد وأنتم حرم إن الله يحكم ما يريد. الله يحكم ما يريد. الله establishes what he wants.
In this ayat, Allah addresses the believers. He said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَإِذَا سَمِعْتَ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْقُرْآنِ فَأَنْصِطْ فَإِنَّهُ أَمْرٌ تُؤْمَرُ بِهِ أَوْ نَهْيٌ تُنْهَى عَنْهُ كما قال ابن مسعود. Wherever you hear, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا in the Quran, oh you who believe, if you consider yourself to be amongst the believers, then pay attention. Now, you tell the people around you, be quiet. Allah is going to tell us something to do. Allah is about to tell us something to stay away from. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا over 85 times in the Quran. So here Allah addresses the believers, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا fulfill your contracts, fulfill your oath, fulfill your promises, and do not do 1, 2, 3. At the end Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ مَيْرُ يعني Allah, Allah, establishes the law he wants. No one has other option. يَحْكُمُ مَا يُرِيد. Allah is the one who puts the laws. No one else. So Allah puts the laws. Allah says what you need to do and what you cannot do. Then for us, he gave us the option. I am the one who says you have to pray. But you, human beings, I give you the option. Not the option to choose if you want to pray or not and be fine. La. I want you to pray. If you don't pray, you're in trouble. If you pray, I reward you. But the bottom line is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who established the law of the prayer. No one else. Allah constitutes. وَنَفْسٍ وَحَدْهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Allah gave choice to every soul. Someone will ask, but if everything is written in Lawh al-Mahfuz, when Allah created the pen and told him and ordered the pen to write everything. First of all, the pen did not write from his own. Allah ordered him what to write. So they say, if everything is written, why should we work? If everything is written, that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already wrote a way or a path or a scenario for my life, a script that I have to go through with. I got no option. So how can I say I have the choice? First, understand very well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not constricted and not limited to time. For us, there is tomorrow, future, there is past. There is no such thing for Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was limited to time, then he needs to wait until tomorrow to know what's going to happen tomorrow. That takes away from him the attribute of Allah, the all-knowing. So there is no such thing for Allah as past, present, and future. These things for us. So if there is no such thing, that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already seen your life. He's not limited. You are limited. You don't know what you're going to do tomorrow until you live tomorrow. Yes, you have plans. You don't know if you're going to do them or not. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't limited by time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if this dunya, يعني, let's say 10,000 years, this 10,000 years script, Allah has seen already. Because al-alim, that means he knows things before they happen. Before they happen to you. Okay? Very simple. And know very well, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has coerced you to live what's written in the book and you got no option, then rest and relax and be comfortable, because He will not punish you for what
he forced you to do.
Because he's al-adil, huh?
Allah is all just, right? Allah doesn't oppress people. So how can he judge you and throw you in hell for something you got no choice, he forced you to do? We know in Islam, if you are forcefully say, I disbelieve in Allah, someone holding something to you, and they will shoot. If you tell them you're Muslim, and you go and you say, I'm a Jew, I'm a Hindu, I'm Christian like you. Okay? Fine, do it. إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنُّ بِالْإِيمَانِ. The Prophet ﷺ told this to Yasir, Ammar ibn Yasir. Remember when the Kuffar and Quraysh kept torturing him, huh, to leave Islam, and he did with his words, but his heart was still comfortable with Islam. The Prophet ﷺ told him what? If they come back, then do it again. Say it again. Huh? Say the word of Kufr. This doesn't count. If someone is forced, yani someone is abusing my daughter, her husband, and I go to him and I say, you need to divorce her right now. And I'm holding a weapon to his head. Or I'm a big guy, so he's scared of me. He doesn't want a divorce. But he's so scared that I will really, huh, pull the trigger. So he divorces her. Doesn't count in any time. In Islam, doesn't count. She's still his wife and no divorces. So very important to understand. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is His law, yet we're going to say, if everything is written, that means I am coerced and it's already been predetermined and pre-chosen for me what to do in life, then Allah will not punish you. So either way, you're fine. Yet, don't commit the haram and say, that's what Allah wrote for me. Why? The very next question we tell you, how did you know? Someone wants to go and commit zina, wal-iyadu billah. No? He wants to kill someone. You tell him, la bro, haram. Allah will punish you. La, everything is predetermined. Tay. How do you know? You looked in the book, in Lawh al-Mahfuz, and you saw that Allah wrote, you're going to kill this person. So now you justify it for yourself, it's already written. La. No one looked in that book. None of us. Anyone here? La. So how you know? So how you going to use that as an excuse to commit your haram? La. So be careful. But the bottom line and what we believe in, huh? Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, huh? That you have the choice. L'insan mukhayyar. And there are groups in Islam came about to say otherwise. Some went this extreme, some went that extreme. Huh? Al-Jabriya, huh? And al-Qadariya. Al-Jabriya said, you got no choice. You live the way Allah forces you to. You got no choice of what you do. Al-Qadariya said the other way. There is no Qadr. Their name Al-Qadariya, but they say no Qadr. Whatever you do, Allah has no control over. La. In general, someone will do something haram, commit zina, adultery, steal, kill. Allah did not order him to do that. Allah does not love that. Huh? Allah does not approve that. Yet he did it under the control of Allah. Yani he did not something that Allah did not know. He did not do something that Allah did not allow. Because if we say, some people went the extreme, Allah did not allow him to do that, but he did it, we are taking away from Allah that he is the controller of everything. Allah tested him and he failed. That's how you look. You look at it. But the bottom line is, وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Allah says, say the truth from your Lord. Who wants to believe, believes. Who wants to disbelieve, disbelieves. It's a matter
of his own choice. الجبروت لله واحد. And this is, we can يعني sit here for hours to talk about this word, that الجبروت for Allah وحده. Huh? Allah وحده, and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has the right for the full control. Allah is the one, the only one who has the right to say, you do this and that's what needs to be done. You don't do this and that's what not need to be done. The only one. No one else, huh? No one else has that right. And the prophets and the messengers of Allah who have that right is because they got it from Allah. They credited with it from Allah. But if you're someone who's in charge of ra'iyya, huh? You're a father over kids, you're a husband over wife, you're a president and a leader over ra'iyya and over a country, don't think you have the absolute power and jabarut. You don't. Don't think you're so good that anything you say and everything you say has to go. You force them to do something and you're not doing it yourself, because I'm al-jabbar in this house. I'm al-jabbar in this country. I'm not the president. I don't have any president you guys want me to resign from. You guys rule, but then I gonna bomb you if you don't listen to me. And that is not only... That is happening by the biggest and the most claimed, self-claimed, democratic, civilized countries. The point is, you work at your level. You're a husband in a house, hold your horses. Not everything you say has to go. But everything that is permissible goes. Everything that is haram doesn't go. Don't say, don't do this, and you run, you are the first one to do it. It doesn't work like that. بالمعروف. You don't want her to look at haram, you don't look at haram. That doesn't mean if she's looking at haram, you're justified to look at haram. La. But the point is, if the name al-Jabbar of Allah, as Imam al-Sa'di rahimahullah said, one of the meaning is al-Ra'uf. Al-Ra'uf, يعني the one who fixes the broken hearts. So why you choose one of the meanings and you neglect the others? Why? Why you want to be Jabbar in the sense of al-Raf'a and al-Quwwa and al-Azama and the strength and the elegance and the majesty and the power and the controlling? But you forget that al-Jabbar also the one who yal'am, yajibur, fixes the broken hearts. That's what we learn from these names. Allah can strike, and He did. And He did with Qawm Hud, Ad. And He did with Qawm Salih, Thamun. And He did with Qawm Shu'ayb. And He did. But yet, He didn't do with Qawm Yunus. And He didn't do with Quraysh and with the Kuffar of the Arabs. Allah knows if they will believe or if they will not. That is with umam. So what's the deal with you? You're in charge of a family of one or two or three, and you are jabbar taghiyah. Have mercy. Rahmati sabaqat ghadabi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my mercy preceded my wrath. That's what you learn from these names. Brother talk about al-Jabbar means al-Azim and the great and the powerful and the controlling. I gonna be like that. يا أخي in Islam even the enemies have rights. Even the enemies have rights. Wallahi, we hear stories and people call us and they have problems. Especially, يعني, for some reason it's happening so often these days with spouses and marital problems. يعني stuff you can't even imagine. Dude, why are they living together? Wallahi, يعني, you don't treat your enemy like that. So let's be wise, let's learn, let's build a healthy, compatible, strong family so we can have a strong society. We're so excited and well, yes, this president is being toppled and this guy is going away and this guy is down and this guy is going to be killed. The society needs to be healthy to take over. It's not, and it was never taking someone up, down, the hard part. It's what's next. What's next? Have we done our jobs with our own families and our own selves and our own responsibilities to deserve it, tamkeen and the establishment in the earth? ونريد أن نمن على الذين استضعفوا في الأرض ونجعلهم أئمة. Do we have that core, that prerequisites? Everyone can do that, working on his own. You do that with your family. 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 I do that with my family. خلاص, we're done. It's that easy. That easy. But no one will fix your problems if you choose not to. So be compassionate, be merciful. Yes, be serious, be tough when it's required. But to take being tough as a way of life will not work. You will cause more damage. So very important to understand. So only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has the full control. What He says goes without question. Without question. But in a house, in a country, the husband, قوامة. The husband has the upper hand in the house. The wife needs to listen. But once he tells or he says wrong and he orders haram, then there is no obedience in that aspect. So very important. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who will order and you will have to fulfill. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not order you to do the haram. Okay? Very important to understand this point. Only Allah, when He described Himself, He says, لا يسألوا عما يفعل وهم يسألون. Allah doesn't say that specific people, doesn't say about generations, doesn't say about people. He says about Himself. لا يسألوا عما, He is not to be asked about what He does. And they are asked. So if I gonna come and say, don't ask me about what I do. I do whatever I want, it's okay. For me, it's okay. I'm in charge of you. He had competed with Allah with one of His characters. تخيل. Someone challenging Allah. He says to, in other words, he says, oh Allah, you said that you're the only one. I wanna share that with you. Alright, so very important to understand that. That's very much يعني with this name. And I just finished that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to use this name in his dua, okay, in his salah, to show you the importance of this name. So the dua the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to make بين السجدتين, when you make sajda and then you sit down and before you go to the next sajda, there is dua reporting, What is the dua? اللهم ارحمني واغفر لي واجبرني. واجبرني. Very important. اجبرني. You ask Allah, oh Allah have mercy on me. Forgive me, اجبرني. Okay? اجبرني in this instance, perhaps help me to fix my affairs. يعني keep me on the path that my affairs are all straight and fixed. مجبرني وارفعني واهدني وعافني وارزقني. Alright, and also the dua in the ruku' and the sujood. You guys don't make dua? سبحان ذي الجبروت والملكوت والكبرياء والعظمة. شوف هذا الدعاء. شوف. Understand this dua. And I promise you, you will never be scared. سبحان ذي الجبروت والملكوت والكبرياء والعظم. أبعد الله كبير؟ أبعد الله عظيم؟ أبعد الله جبار؟ لا. لا إله إلا الله. لا إله إلا الله. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفروا الله لي ولكم، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد. جزاكم الله خير. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.